Game three of the National League Division Series, the Cubs and the Braves. A pivotal game, of course, in a short series. It's now really a best of three series. And the Cubs have jumped ahead against Greg Maddux, 2-0 here at Wrigley. A lot more baseball tomorrow. The division series will continue. 1 o'clock Eastern, 12 Central, 10 Pacific on ESPN. The Yankees and the Twins, pivotal game three. Clemens and Loesch for the Metrodome at the same time on ESPN2. The Giants and Marlins. And for the Giants, they must win or they will go home for the winter. Jerome Williams, a rookie, or maybe Jason Schmidt, the veteran for the Giants, against rookie Dontrell Willis at 4 o'clock on Fox. These Braves against these Cubs right here at Wrigley. Russ Ortiz against Matt Clement. And then 7:30 tomorrow night, Joe and I will be at Fenway Park for the Athletics and the Red Sox. The Red Sox in a must-win game, desperation game, a loss for the Red Sox tomorrow, and they go home for the winter. Here is Andrew Jones hitting sixth in the order. Pops it up foul. And the count, one ball and one strike. Matt Clement tomorrow. Clement, who pitched a very strong game for the Cubs last Saturday when they swept that doubleheader from the Pirates and clinched the division title. Here's that curve from Pryor outside. Two balls and a strike. Robert Fick on deck, then Vinny Castilla. Now, we also saw the effects of the rains during the first inning here. And the infield was left exposed for a while. Ooh, that fastball just off the outside.
Well, see, that's the pitch that they would swing at if there was two strikes. So him falling behind allowed Andrew to be able to lay off that pitch. But with two strikes, I guarantee he would have swung at that.
3-1 to the powerful Andrew Jones, and he draws a walk. So Pryor, a little bit off, and you don't know if it's the extra adrenaline pitching in a huge game for the first time in his young career, or the cold, the wet, or a combination of all of that.
I actually just think that that's the adrenaline, because John, the Cubs and Pryor and Wood, Clement, they've been pitching playoff type pressure the last 2 weeks of the season. You know, they were close to Houston, they've had to win, so they've been pitching under this type of pressure for the last three or four starts apiece.
And it's a strike in the outside to Fick.
So I don't think it's the pressure. I think he's just, maybe he's wanting to throw a little bit too hard, rushing a little bit.
He's facing Robert Fick here, who really wants a base hit. He succumbed to the wet grass. Now this one could be a double play. Grudzielanek to second one, Gonzalez to first. Double play. And these are not the best of times for Fick. He's having a hard time defensively and is now 0 for 7 at the plate.
Well, a good job by Grudzielanek and Gonzalez to make this double play, because it wasn't a routine double play. The ball wasn't hit that hard, and they had to turn it quickly at second base. Pryor gets the ground ball. Watch how quickly, right there, a quick turn by Gonzalez, and they get Fick at first base.
Two down, nobody on. Vinny Castilla. Fastball. Wow. When's the last time you saw Vinny take a first pitch fastball?
Well, that was over the outside part of the plate. I mean, if you're Vinny, you walk up there, you want your fastball to be middle in. And that was right on the outside corner.
0-1. Back out there again.
Yeah. See, that's the pitch that Andrew Jones laid off of because he was ahead in the count. But you do not lay off of it if you're behind in the count.
Well, Pryor walked the first batter, but then got the double play. Now he's starting to look like Pryor again. 0-2. And a pop foul back into the upper deck.
Well, that's the first ball he's gotten into the middle of the plate. And he was 0-2. It was right in the middle. Now watch. We've seen the other two right on the outside. Watch where this pitch is.
Ooh.
Right in the middle of the plate.
And Vinny doesn't miss those too often. Back to the breaking ball in the dirt now. A ball and two strikes to Vinny Castilla. Two down, nobody on. The Cubs lead 2-0.
That's what having a great fastball will do. It allow you to make mistakes sometimes and not get hurt.
Well, just before the All-Star break, Pryor had a collision with Marcus Giles of the Braves running the bases. Put him out for almost a month. Back to the curve again. But when he came back, he was better than ever. He won 10 of his last 11 decisions. And, I mean, the Cubs needed every one of them, or they wouldn't be here right now. And We asked Dusty Baker about that, if there was something that he did better. And Dusty thought, well, the time off gave his arm a chance to rest a little bit. He thinks that gave him that much more strength for the stretch run.
And he also said that his control was a little better when he came back after the rest.
Here's the play we're talking about. That's Pryor, the base runner.
And you can see him grab his shoulder once he hits the ground right there. He comes down on his shoulder, and he grabs it. And Giles had a concussion, and he was out, had to miss his All-Star game.
I mean, Giles had dizziness. Benny hits that fastball high in the air, shallow left center. Gonzalez signaling for help, and there's Moises Alou, and the inning is over. Cubs 2, Braves nothing. To the last of the second we go in Chicago. Greg Maddux back in the hill now. 2-0 the score. Maddux and the Braves are down in this one. And here is Damian Miller, the eighth place hitter, bouncing a foul off to the left.
Well, the one thing to remember, when you have Mark Pryor in the lineup, you have 9 hitters in the lineup, not just 8. I mean, he's a very good hitter. So it doesn't come easy for Maddux when you get to the ninth spot.
And that's a called strike. Well, such a good hitter. Remember, in our telecast Wednesday, Dusty Baker was down to only one non-pitcher available on his bench, Troy O'Leary. And he was considering using Mark Pryor as a pinch hitter in that ninth inning if the game had not been a 5-3 Braves lead, but rather still tied. So, I mean, he is a very fine hitter. Pryor hit 250, and in 72 at-bats, he had 4 doubles and a homer. 0-2 the count to Damian Miller facing Greg Maddux. Maddux, who might be pitching his final game for the Braves. I mean, he's certainly hoping he'll pitch games for them in the League Championship Series and the World Series. But if things don't work out well for the Braves, if they get eliminated in this series, this could be his last game for them. And a sinker low and outside for a ball. 1-2. He's in the final year of a contract again this year. And he said he would prefer to stay in Atlanta next year, but there's no guarantee that will happen. The third, Vinny Castillo.
Nice play.
One away. Let's go down now to the field, and here's Gary Miller.
John, you mentioned earlier that Greg Maddux and Javi Lopez haven't been a battery combination in 5 years, since 98. But Javi had the greatest power season ever for a catcher, setting the home run record behind the plate. So they knew they'd meet up and need his bat in the postseason. So the last 3 starts, he caught Maddux for the first time in the regular season in all that time. 17 innings, he gave up just 3 earned runs. He had a 1.59 ERA, and he went unbeaten in those 3 starts. In fact, if he hadn't gotten that 1.59 ERA, he already had the highest ERA of his career. It would have been over 4 without those 3 nice starts.
All right, so Javi had some success working with Greg Maddux.
Well, it's not just that. I mean, when Maddux first went over there, I mean, he won a Cy Young Award, you know, pitching to Javi Lopez. So it's not that they cannot work together.
Mark Pryor. The high hop for Kyle. Pryor just jogging up the first baseline. And is an easy out. 2 men gone.
Well, the one thing we should make the point is that Greg Maddux did not give up a lot of line drives in that first inning. There was the bunt that was misplayed at first base, and 2 soft line drives hit the right field, one by Randall Simon that drove in 2 runs, one by Kenny Lofton that got the inning started. So it wasn't that they beat him around or knocked him around. It's just circumstances allowed the Cubs to score 2 runs.
I mean, 2 of them really were balls that traveled banana-shaped arcs off the bat and into right field.
You're such a wordsmith.
In England, they would call those banana balls.
Oh, bananas.
Yeah, that's a phrase they use in soccer in England. So, it's not really a hit. Well, you hit a banana ball out there. And then, Ramirez just hit a little bouncer through the right side. Now, that's a line drive. And in for a base hit. Hit hard by Lofton. He's 2-for-2.
Well, let's see if sometime during this at bat he'll try to steal a base. Fastball, it was supposed to be toward the outside corner, and it gets a lot of the plate down, and Lofton rips it to right field for a base hit. One of the things I'm noticing is they're playing the guys toward the right field line, both the left-handed hitters and the right-handed hitters, meaning the Braves, over here.
And they're playing the same way for the right-handed batting Grudzielanek as they were for the left-handed batting Lofton.
Yeah, and I'm trying to figure that out, but I'm sure they have their scouting reports or, you know, they have the maps of where these guys have hit the ball, you know, during the season against Greg Maddux.
You know, Lofton, as we saw with K-Zone, where that pitch was that he hit for the base hit, told us before the game that, you know, when Maddux is in the strike zone, he's hittable, and Lofton is running. Lopez throws. It's a bad throw. It's deflected and into right center, and Lofton will go to third. Forcal got a glove on it, but only succeeded in deflecting it away from Giles, who had hustled over to back it up.
Well, and that's what you want to do. If you're Kenny Lofton, you get on base, I'm going to make something happen. And that's the way to play the game, especially against Greg Maddux. I mean, during the season, they were successful 26 out of 34 attempts against Maddux. He doesn't really get a great jump, though. But it was a tough pitch for Lopez. His throw is offline. And they were, as you mentioned, Percal knocked it away from Giles.
So now runner at third, and they're doing the sarcastic tomahawk chop again here at Wrigley. Down and away.
I mean, when you have 27 stolen bases out of 35 attempts, you know, that tells you that you should run and keep running and put pressure on Maddux, because it has to be Maddux, because remember, Javi Lopez wasn't catching him during all that time.
A ball and a strike, runner at third, and he takes it. Pretty good eye there by Grudzielanek. 2-1. He had a bunt single his first time that, again, it was scored as a hit, and I think rightly so, but Fick slipped on the grass and kind of mishandled it. You see that K-Zone agreed with Grudzielanek on that one. The Braves made a lot of errors this year. They were not really a very good defensive team. That's deep to right. Sheffield into the corner, and he makes the catch.
Good thing they were playing him down the right field line, right? See, they have those scouting reports.
Worked out perfectly on that one. Still 2-0 Cubs. Top of the third, Greg Maddux to lead off for the Atlanta Braves against Mark Pryor. Pryor and the Cubs out in front, 2-0. Rafael Forcal, the leadoff man, is on deck. And then Giles. Fastball in there for a strike. You got the young Pryor against the old hand and the great Greg Maddux. 289 lifetime wins, 4 Cy Young awards. Maddux popping a foul. And there have been some matchups like that over the years on big stages. 1966, Jim Palmer, 20 years old, up against Sandy Koufax. And Palmer beat Koufax in that World Series. Tom Seaver, Mike Cuellar, the 69 World Series. And the young Seaver beat Cuellar, the veteran. Dwight Gooden, Nolan Ryan, 1986 League Championship Series. And Gooden got the best of the Ryan Express. That's a foul. And John Smoltz of the Braves up against Jack Morris in the 1991 World Series, Game 7. And that was a great matchup as well. And Smoltz got the best of that one. And we didn't even know about Smoltz yet.
Yeah, but you're not talking about just average young pitchers. You're talking about guys that went on to stardom and, you know, became very, very good pitchers. And that's what you expect from Mark Pryor. You expect him to go ahead and become, you know, one of those stars over the course of his career.
Jim Palmer got his nickname from that World Series game, Cakes. They showed him in the newspaper having a stack of pancakes, as he said he always, before he would start a big game, would eat a stack of pancakes. And to his teammates ever after, the future Hall of Famer, Jim Palmer, was known as Cakes. One ball, two strikes to Greg Maddux. Maddux hits one in the air to right field. Sosa easing to his left. And the wind has picked up a little bit, by the way. Number one. Mark DeRosa of the Braves is wearing a microphone. He was talking to his teammate Chipper Jones about Pryor.
It looks hard, but it don't look like giddy up he had that one time.
Harder once you get up there.
Yeah. Exactly. I know.
I like that. It's harder once you get up there. It's kind of easy sitting over here in the dugout. Doesn't look that hard. It's like up here. It doesn't look that hard from up here, John. But I know once you step in that batter's box, there is some giddy up on the fastball.
Well, DeRosa, I think, is very perceptive, though, because, you know, they remember Pryor throwing 97 miles an hour. And we haven't seen too many. Most of his fastball have been around 93, 94 in this one.
Well, one thing to remember, it's a cool night, you know, and it's, the wind's blowing. I mean, you're not going to be as loose as you would be on a midsummer afternoon or a midsummer evening.
For Cow, the little bloop behind the mound, racing in, Grudzielanek, a dive, and he makes the catch! A little slow in getting up. He might have hurt himself. Not quite like Billy Martin in the World Series back in 52 or 53. He caught one in front of the mound racing in from second base. But it'll do. He got the job done.
Well, good pitch by Pryor right in on the hands of Furcal. Right there, he just kind of pops it up. And if this ball hits the ground, it's a base hit. Grudzielanek, but you can see his front, watch his right arm going to the ground first, right, watch his elbow right there, and he jars his elbow, and that's,
there's a bloop by Giles, and that's going to be a base hit into right center. Giles, who struck out his first time, gets the Braves' first hit of this game. Pryor had walked three in the first 2 innings, and that keeps in and going for Gary Sheffield now. 2-0, the Cubs lead Atlanta. The powerful Sheffield coming up. Sheffield, who was 1-for-16 in that division series against the Giants last year, 1-for-8 so far in this one. And although, you know, he feels like he's swinging well, he's making hard contact. Bobby Cox is saying it. But, you know, Sheffield would like to break out and just actually start getting some hits here. And start being Gary Sheffield. I mean, that's got to play in your mind a little bit for Gary Sheffield. Although, as he said the other night, he says, hey, you know, all you can do is hit it hard. I mean, you can't really guide it. If it goes right at somebody, well, that's bad luck for you.
Well, one of the things he's done, though, is he's pulled the ball down the third baseline most of the time. And, you know, during the season, he hit 330, and that he was using the entire field a little bit more.
Well, the shortstop, Gonzalez, was over into the hole to begin with. And they get the force out on Giles at second with Grudzielanek covering. Sheffield is gone. Sosa, Alou, and Simon coming up for the Cubs.
ESPN's presentation of the 2003 MLB Division Series. Brought to you by flexible enterprise systems that are easy to buy, easy to own, easy as Dell. And American Airlines. Choose the airline that fits your schedule, not the other way around.
I'm John Miller with Joe Morgan tonight. From Wrigley Field, Chicago, the Atlanta Braves trailing the Cubs 2-0. The series tied at a game apiece. Now Sammy Sosa, the power coming up for the Cubs. Sosa, Alou, and then Randall Simon against Greg Maddux. Sammy reaching for one. Furcal ranging to his left to get it and throws him out. So Sammy, who struck out his first time, out on the first pitch this time.
Well, the Baker boys, as they're called here in Chicago, they better not try to sit on this lead and think that leave it for Mark Pryor to shut the Braves down. You need to try to build on what you have. Good pitch there by Maddux, as usual, just out of the zone. And he got Sammy to chase it. And a nice play there by Furcal.
Furcal, remember, was way over into the hole toward the third baseline for Sammy.
But what he did there, John, is he cut it off. He didn't run around it. He just went and cut it off.
Moises Alou yanks one foul into the seats near the Cubs' bullpen. Alou flied out to center his first time. Now, Sammy Sosa was on that Cubs team in 98 that played the Braves. The Cubs won the wild card, beating the Giants in a playoff. But that series was over in a hurry. Maddux won the clinching game right here at Wrigley. Alou hammers one to left, but a liner. And caught by Chipper Jones.
Well, they hit a couple of bloops that fell in the first inning. They're hitting some line drives now that are getting caught.
The final out of the second inning, Grudzielanek hit one real well down the right field line. And this one was really clobbered by Moises, but just didn't get under that ball at all. Fans out there in Waveland Avenue, but you can see the flags up there, the retired numbers of Ernie Banks and Ron Santo flying from the left field foul pole, blowing in. Randall Simon, a sinker off the outside for ball one. Simon got the clutch. Two out hit to drive in the Cubs 2 runs in the first inning. 2 down, nobody on here in the third. 1 ball, no strikes. Simon goes after one, and Giles plays the high hop, and the Cubs are gone in a hurry in the third inning, a 5-pitch inning for Maddux. Chipper Jones, Javi Lopez, and Andrew Jones. Three powerful hitters coming up. 2-0 Cubs. Cubs with five hits. The Braves with one as we start the fourth inning. The middle of the Atlanta order coming up. Chipper Jones, Javi Lopez, and Andrew Jones against Mark Pryor. Pryor walked three in the first two innings, very uncharacteristically for him. Here in Chicago, could this be the year? I mean, they always want to believe the Cubs, of course, have not even been in a World Series since 1945. They've not won one since 1908. Chipper fouls one back and out of play.
Well, John, I was always taught when you face a guy that throws real hard, you don't swing harder trying to catch up with it. You swing quicker. And that may be semantics for a lot of people, but what it really means is you try to make sure you get your hands out there, use your hands more than you use your body.
To shortstop, Alex Gonzalez, out number one.
But since I was taught that way, and it worked, let's listen to a batting champion talk about how he would handle Mark Pryor.
Whatever the ball was pitched, like a regular game, you know, whatever the ball's pitched, if it's outside, just swing with the ball over there. Well, I want to stay back.
Okay.
I want to use my hands because when my hands are working good, that's mean that my lower body is working good.
Okay.
But if my hands are all over the plate, my lower body is going to be all over the plate. That's when you start jumping. It doesn't matter who's throwing out there. It could be throwing 100 miles per hour. The more harder they throw, the more concentration and relax that I am, because I know that I'm going to create some bad speed with my hand.
And that's what he's talking about. Relax your hands and throw your hands at the back, at the ball, instead of using your body and swinging harder. Just swing quicker. And no one does it better than Albert Pujols.
And Javi Lopez did it well a few times this year.
Yeah.
43 home runs. He has a count of 0-2, though, here against Mark Pryor. Yeah, well, with Albert Pujols' credentials, he's sort of the hitting version of Mark Pryor.
Yeah.
I mean, he's a prodigy, a phenom at a very young age. He's already one of the best in the game. Got on top of that fastball. Gonzalez, plenty of time. Two men down.
And if you're Dusty Baker, you like what you see here, John, because you're not ringing up a high pitch count for Mark Pryor, and he is relaxed throwing strikes and forcing them to make, you know, contact. It looks great when you strike out 11 or 12 hitters, but if you have to throw 100 pitches in six innings to do it, then it hurts you over the course of the ball game. So he's happy to see those first two hitters go out on a couple of pitches.
And that's always been a concern this year. Pryor has thrown a lot of pitches in many of his games. In fact, he averaged 130 pitches per start in his six September starts.
And you do not want that here in September to continue. You know, you do not want it to continue, although we've gone into October now.
But all the more reason they don't want it to continue,
right?
And Pryor, I mean, he's never pitched in October before. This is new territory for him. 0-2 to Andrew Jones. Two down and nobody on, the crowd on its feet. And the curve misses. 1-2. Pryor got that extra day of rest, which at this time of year is always a blessing since his last start. Jones chased that curve and rolled it softly foul to the left. Pryor pitched last Saturday against the Pirates, the first game of that huge doubleheader, the doubleheader that they swept and clinched the division title in so doing. So since then, he has not pitched until tonight. 1-2. Was inside with the fastball. 2-2.
And the one thing you always have to like about Pryor when you watch him pitch, he will come inside. And whether you're right-handed or left-handed, he keeps you honest.
Ooh, just off the outside with that breaking ball. Andrew had nerves of steel to take that one with two strikes.
Well, after a pitch inside, you're not going to go diving out to get this breaking ball. It's, well, that's pretty much well off the plate. That's a bad sequence right there of pitching, too, because he had him 0-2, and you walk him without giving him another pitch, your good fastball, which is your best pitch.
So the fourth walk by Pryor, it's twice that he's walked Andrew Jones.
But when you go 0-2, John, and your second pitch was your good fastball to get to the second strike, it's okay to throw a couple breaking balls away or a fastball in, but you can't go to 3-2. The 2-2 pitch should have been a real good fastball.
Now Robert Fink, he hit a double play ball in his first time. He's 0-7 in this series. Backdoored him with the breaking ball for a strike.
And he has been able to throw the breaking ball to left-handers for strikes better than he has to the right-handers, because I think he's always trying to hit the outside edge with the right-handed pitchers, and the left-hander, he's bringing it from the other side.
Andrew Jones runs well, back to the bag at first. Greg Maddux getting some mud off his spikes during the between innings break for him. One ball, one strike to Fink.
And John, what I meant by throwing, you throw him a couple of curveballs as he did Andrew Jones, that makes him have to wait a hair longer. That makes your fastball 4 miles faster than it actually is, because he's waiting a little longer with two strikes because you've just thrown him a couple of curveballs.
Fick into right center. Lofton loses his cap, but he grabs the ball and the inning is over. One man left. Last of the fourth, Ramirez coming up. 2-0 Chicago.
Presentation of the 2003 MLB Division Series, brought to you by Bristol-Myers Squibb Company. Hope, triumph, and the miracle of medicine.
Get to Maddux early, and a lot of teams did this year. Maddux gave up nearly a third of his runs for the whole season in the first inning of games, and the Cubs got to him for two in the first tonight, but more often than not, Maddux then would settle in. And so far he has in this one. Is the count to Aramis Ramirez. Is a ball and a strike. Ramirez got a base hit his first time. Just a bouncer to the right side through the open hole on the right side with the first baseman covering the bag against the runner. Curveball inside. 2-1. Greg Maddux, you mentioned the last time he pitched in the postseason in Wrigley was 1998 when he beat the Cubs to clinch that series. And then, prior to that, the last time was 1989. He pitched in the league championship series against the Giants here for the Cubs. A mighty cut by Ramirez. 2-2.
Well, Greg just kind of reached back and let that fastball go on the inner half of the plate, and Ramirez couldn't catch up with it.
Pitchers have been given permission tonight by the umpires to blow in their hands while on the mound, which is ordinarily not allowed. Ramirez, a high fly ball along the left field line. Against the wind, and Chipper Jones, one away. In 1989, in game one right here at Wrigley, Will Clark got the best of the young Greg Maddux. 14 years ago, Will hit a home run to right center, and then later on, he hit a grand slam, which was just a smash out onto Sheffield Avenue. You know, Will Clark said that, you know, Don Zimmer, just before that at bat, had gone out to talk to Maddux, and that Clark, and I can't remember whose lips he was reading, but he said he saw either Maddux or Zimmer mouth something like, "I'm going to go fastball in." So Clark went up there, got a fastball in, and hit it out onto the streets of Chicago for a grand slam. One out. Here's Alex Gonzalez. Castillo was playing him shallow and couldn't handle that one. Forcal runs it down in shallow left field, and it's an error on Vinny Castillo.
Well, you're right. He was playing in very shallow, and he got the in-between hop. He didn't have a chance, you know, to maneuver back or forward. If anything, he's got to come forward right there, but it was too far in front of him, so being that shallow, he wasn't able to read the bounce. He started in, and then he had to back up. And that was all caused because he was playing in shallow, thinking that Gonzalez protecting against the bunt.
That is the second Atlanta error. And it'll bring up Damian Miller. Lopez out to the mound, meanwhile, talking to Greg Maddux. Maddux had another start in that 89 series and got roughed up again, got knocked out early. And overall, gave up 11 earned runs in 7 1/3 innings to the Giants that year. And that was the World Series where Will Clark put on one of the great shows that any hitters ever put on in a postseason series, except in the same series, Mark Grace did almost the same stuff that Clark was doing. It was worth the price of admission just to see those two guys. They both hit over 600 in that league championship series.
Well, one of the things the Cubs have put on Greg's mind is that they will run. And you see him call, he called Javi Lopez out, and now he's throwing over to first base. They have his attention.
Well, they're running, and they pitch out. And a good throw this time by Javi.
Well, that's one of the ways to combat base dealers.
Well, they saw that one coming, didn't they?
Yeah, well, they definitely did. And you wonder sometimes why you would go on the very first pitch. And you see the pitch out. Good pitch out. Good throw.
Miller now with two down and nobody on. I have a theory about why he went on the first pitch.
Give me that theory.
Well, guys usually are aggressive against Maddox. They do a lot of first ball swinging because they're afraid of getting behind him. So if you're going to go, you better go early, right?
Yeah, but, I mean, they've showed Maddox that they're going to be aggressive on the bases. And he just called the catcher out. I mean, he calls the catcher out. He throws the first base from one pitch, then he calls the catcher out. I mean, somewhere that should register that, well, he is concerned about me at first base.
So Gonzalez got tagged out a second. He says, you know, maybe they were talking about me when they were talking out there. Two down and nobody on. Miller with a three ball, one strike count. The pitcher, Pryor, is up next. Well, Miller swung it air that time. You know, Eric Karras made a comment to us. He said, facing Maddox is like playing wiffle ball in your backyard as a kid. You know, because the ball looks like it's defying physics. And that pitch was one of them. You swung at it, looked like it was right there, and then it wasn't there. Ran the sinker in under the hands, and it's a foul. Still 3-2. Maddox at this point, though, just trying to keep the Braves close and hope that that great offense will somewhere along the line get it going against Pryor.
Well, a 2-0 lead is not a big lead, so, I mean, if you're the Braves, you do not panic.
Just off the outside. Ball four. The Giants and Marlins played earlier today. Let's get an update from that ballgame with Carl Ravage.
Hi, John. Thank you very much. Those who didn't see it, it was a great game. San Francisco had grabbed the lead in extra innings in the bottom of the 11th. Jeff Conine hit a ball down the right field line with no man out. And Jose Cruz Jr., Bobby Valentine just dropped it.
He dropped it, and Conine didn't run. It worked out to the benefit of the Marlins.
Because Pudge Rodriguez, who had a phenomenal game, comes up with the game-winning RBIs. Earlier in the game, he had homered. Marlins win. They got a 2-1 lead, John.
All right, so the Giants will be trying to avoid elimination tomorrow. Day game in Florida. You'll be able to see it on ESPN2 starting at 1 Eastern, noon Central. Here's Mark Pryor. Felipe Alou said after the ball game that, hey, the Giants just gave that one away. And they did. The only runs the Marlins scored in that game on the two-run homer by Pudge Rodriguez in the very first inning against Kirk Reeder, and then his two-run single in extra innings. So Pudge drove in all four of their runs in a 4-3 win. Dusty Baker studying his notes in the Cubs dugout. He's got Miller at first, Pryor at the plate, 1-1 the count. And a curveball. Maddox shows Pryor some respect there.
Well, they know that he's a good hitter, and he's strong enough to hit the ball out of the ballpark. But the one thing that they were able to accomplish with Maddox walking Miller is that even if he retires him, Kenny Lofton will lead off, and that's what you want. You want Kenny Lofton leading off because with no one on base, he can pick his pitches and try to steal another base.
Lofton led off the first inning with a hit, and that started a two-run rally. That's a foul. Two balls, two strikes. The Atlanta Braves, 12 straight division titles under Bobby Cox. That does not include the year of the strike, 1994, when they were actually in second place to Felipe Alou's Montreal Expos when the season stopped. So in all of the seasons that have been played to a conclusion, though, the last 12, they've finished in first. So Carl can't handle it. And Pryor is out! Well, anybody running but a pitcher would have been safe on that one. The Braves are having a hard time with ground balls in this one. We're going to the fifth inning. Castilla, then Maddox coming up. was close. 2-0 Chicago.